Dyson, and thousands of prototypes, a designer's nightmare. You can't Google vacuum without the name Dyson popping up. Since their first ever launch in the market in the mid-90s, the company's products have become known as the best in the business. Whether it's the fact that their technology requires no dust bags, the vibrant color options, or even that soothing British voice in their commercials that can coax you into doing basically anything they wanted. Nobody can deny it. Dyson vacuums are respected in the same way your dad talks about his truck, but only it's not like a truck, more like a Tesla. Today, the company's creator, Sir James Dyson, has an estimated net worth of $4.6 billion. Not a bad deal for someone who, 20 years ago, was just a guy with a brilliant idea for a better vacuum that he couldn't even sell to a manufacturer if he tried. This idea, mind you, would change the entire vacuum industry forever. James Dyson was born on 2nd May 1947 in a town called Cromer in Norfolk, England. His dad died of cancer when he was just 9 years old. This tragedy affected James a lot, and he found himself lost without his father to guide him. Growing up, he was the runner at Gresham's boarding school from 1956 to 1965. He then went to London to study at the Byam Shaw School of Art for a year before taking up furniture and interior design at the Royal College of Art. He then moved on to engineering. After his graduation, he took a job at Rorschach Controls, where he had an unconventional boss, Jeremy Fry, the man whose encouragement still reflects on Dyson and his empire today. You see, Jeremy was the one who pushed him to be unique and innovative. Dyson's hike to the peak of the vacuum industry started in 1978, when he decided to make a better version of the well-known vacuums at the time. He believed that a vacuum that had a bagless vacuum that didn't lose suction could do wonders for the market. It was an idea that seemed so simple yet so absurd, yet Dyson knew it was the only path for him. Now, how did he even come up with such an idea, you may ask? Well, it's quite simple, really. He saw a 30-foot high windmill shaped like a cone that spun dust out of the air. With that, he figured a smaller version could just as easily be used as a vacuum that didn't need a bag, a vacuum that didn't lose its suction over time. And with that, Dyson had a unique and innovative idea. It was a difficult process. After all, Rome wasn't built in a day. It took Dyson a total of 5,127 prototypes to perfect his vacuum. That was 15 years of trial, error, and struggles. By the time he reached prototype number 2,627, he had lost almost all his money. But he didn't give up. After prototype 3,727, Dyson's wife took it upon herself to bring in a stable income by teaching art. During it all, Dyson strived for perfection. He kept testing, failing, adapting, and evolving until he had the perfect product to take to the market. The DC01 was the first of the series and the first ever vacuum with his patented cyclone innovation. Complete with the infamous yellow, clear canister where one could see all the residue and dust gather. This was probably one of his most famous inventions till date. With his dream plan in motion, Dyson thought licensing the model to another company would be an easy task to do. All things considered, who wouldn't want to be associated with a vacuum that beat all others? Unfortunately, the answer was no one. Companies rejected Dyson's revolutionary product. He was young and idealistic. Dyson thought that corporations would leap at his genius idea the minute he pitched it to them. But how good of a success story would it be if that happened? Dyson went through the next 3 years venturing to the far corners of the world and attempting, unsuccessfully, to sell his vacuum. The companies that turned him down were right about one thing. It was a smart thought. Despite his powerlessness to sell the plan to a large-scale producer and attempting licensing with a United States organization, which turned out to be what he called a disaster, during the 80s, Dyson had the option to create and sell his vacuum with the help of a little licensing company called Apex Limited. The G-Force was made of hot pink plastic, sold for $2,000 and was just accessible in Japan. The expensive device, which also changed into a tabletop to save space, became something of a status symbol and won the 1991 International Design Fair in Japan. Sales there helped Dyson head off all alone to create the Dyson Company in 1993. It was then he finally realized that he had the power alone to bring his vision to life. And that's exactly what he did. Dyson made sure the product fit the need, culture, and aesthetic of Japan, something they would immediately fall in love with. The G-Force highlighted the versatility, compassion, and respect Dyson had for other people, an aspect that got Dyson where it is today. The rest, as they say, is history. That year, Dyson set up his own shop in Cotswolds, England, and grew a business that immediately turned into a household name in the United Kingdom and later the world. What you may not realize is that Dyson wasn't only a company making vacuums. You know those insanely powerful hand dryers at movie theaters and airport bathrooms? The ones that make you feel like your skin just might blow off. That, along with popularized hair dryers and other hairstyling products, were all made by Dyson. A true question here would be, what haven't they tried? They later released a ball-shaped vacuum for ease of movement, had a rejected washing machine venture that cost them a lot of money in 2012, yet they pushed on, dipping their feet in almost every opportunity, accepting new ideas throughout their journey. Now, you can look at this as an attempt to try their hand at everything. But the interesting part is that Dyson actually delivered. Even if the hairstyling tools might seem expensive, they're the best. No one can beat them. They're the most top quality tools you can get in the market. Today, Dyson says he actually likes the risk and the potential for disappointment that comes with the process of being remarkable, especially when it comes to his colleagues and employees. To Dyson, the joy in listening to other people's visions and ideas, providing them with a space to think and create while fully using the resources they have, was his goal. It's no surprise that Dyson was well liked by people around, always motivating them to think and create new ideas. He created an environment for entrepreneurs to come forward and share their ideas. For with experience, he knows that all it takes is one good idea. As far as the companies who turned him down many years back are concerned, well, it sucks to be them. Get it? Sucks? Cause vacuum. In 2002, Hoover had to pay Dyson something over $4.2 million, following a year's worth of a patent encroachment claim. A court found that Hoover's triple vortex vacuums were an unapologetic attempt at duplicating Dyson's plan, the same cyclone technology he offered them a decade earlier. Now that's gotta hurt. Talk about secondhand embarrassment. Whatever the case may be, Dyson showed the world what he was capable of without being bitter about it. He didn't mind the rejection, he just rose above it all. In my mind, he is and will forever be one of the best designers the world has ever seen. Dyson took his vision and made it into something that was not only tangible, but literally helped people across the globe clean easier. If you enjoyed this video, consider hitting the like and subscribe buttons. It does wonders for the YouTube algorithm, so more people can see our videos and so that you can be notified when we launch our next video. We try and put out at least one new one per week, and as you can imagine, the research and editing alone of these type of videos takes us close to 18 hours. So we would really appreciate it if you could also check out our Patreon. For just $1 a month, you can support our work. We produce over 12 videos per month, so that is literally 8 cents per video. Thank you so much, and we'll see you at our next Unmasking.